So as I said, this is going to be an overview of the instrument, but mainly of the product. So this is the PACS spectrometer team at the NHSC. So in particular, you have seen me already yesterday when we get the PACS photometer talk. Tomorrow we are going to see Dario Fada, who is there, and he's going to talk about the unchopped pipeline, and he will show you how, also how to fit PACS spectrometer lines with the spectrum feeder. Jeff Jacobson, who is not in the room, is our developer, and I also need to hear Phil, who is actually the person, the task leader for the whole NHSC, but he's been in the PACS team, PACS spectrometer team for many years, and he has a very in-depth knowledge of this data. And he will give talks later today. As I said yesterday, you know, I just want to stress this point that this is meant to be really like, really like an introduction, so feel free to contact the NHSC help desk for any question and problems with your spectrometer data. So this is my instrument slide, which you have seen already yesterday, but today I want to focus on the spectrometer side. So for those of you who were not here yesterday during the spectrometer talks, as I said, the PACS is really two instruments, so the photometer, which is a bolometer array, and then the spectrometer, which is made of two germanium gallium arrays. The photometer, the spectrometer, the important part about it is that the PACS spectrometer is a spectrometer is an ISU, so it's an integral field of field unit, so it allows to take 2D spectra of sources. And you will see me going through this point over and over again because this is a very important point for the PACS spectrometer. So the field of view is 47 arc seconds by 47 arc seconds with a pixel size, spatial pixel size of 9.4 arc seconds. The wavelength is a delay. The wavelength coverage is between 55 and 210 microns, and this wavelength coverage is split between three orders. So the first order, which is here denoted in red, between 102 and 210 microns. The second order, here in green, between 71 and 98 microns, and the third order, which is between which covers the wavelength range between 55 and 73 microns. Now, during operations, the observers were allowed to cover two orders simultaneously. And the pair of orders was not completely free. So the first order had to be either coupled with the second order or the third order. So the observers couldn't choose the second order and third order. That had to be in a separate, so if the observer wanted to choose these two orders, they had to, in one OR, in one observation, they had to cover the first and fourth order, and in a separate observation, the second order and the third order. So you will always see first coupled with the third or first coupled with the second. Okay, so this is it's about the instrument overview. One word about angular resolution. So because we are dealing with a spectrometer, the angular resolution changes with wavelength. So in the third order, at shorter wavelength, the angular resolution is basically set by the pixel size, the spatial pixel size, which as I said is 9.4 seconds. And at the longer wavelength, the resolution goes up to, or goes down, I should say, to 14, roughly 14 seconds.
Yeah, you should mention that the spectrometer was designed so that it should basically have the same angular size over the whole range, which couldn't be achieved at the longest wavelengths.
Yes,
yeah,
so
they
put that. So this is to put things a little bit in context, as I did yesterday for the photometer. Then it's a comparison of the three Herschel spectrometers, so PACS, Spire, and Hi-Fi. And then it's also a comparison with Spitzer on the shorter wavelengths and the other in particular. So as you can see between the three spectrometers, there is a wavelength overlap, which is only very small with the Spire with the FTS. So it basically there is an overlap of roughly 15 micron, a very tiny overlap here. There is a bigger overlap with the PACS and Hi-Fi spectrometers, and especially with the bands 6 and 7. So this is very important for cross calibration purposes, and also for observational purposes, of course. On the Spitzer side, you can see that the Herschel spectrometers are complementary really with the IRS. I haven't mentioned the MIPS spectrometer because it's the MIPS LCD mode, 70 micron was not extensively used, and that's very so low resolution. Again, you can see the complementarity that was one of the purposes of the design. So this is my second slide on this point, which is the concept, the ISU concept for the PACS spectrometer. So as I said before, the PACS spectrometer allows to take 2D, so two-dimensional spectra of a given source. So how does that work? So the field of view, we have said it's 37 by 47 arc seconds, with a pixel size, with a spatial pixel size that in the PACS world we call stacked. So you will see this word in many, it is very often in the documentation. So stacked is a spatial pixel for the PACS spectrometer. And this is actually, I'm sorry, it's a mistake, not 9.7, it's really 9.4. But the way this works is the following. Basically, when you observe with a spectrometer an object in the sky, there is a slicer that slices the image and reorganizes the image in a row of 25 pixels. So this is a pointer.
You should probably just use the mouse for the people. So there is one person watching.
Okay. So the way this works is that internally to the PACS spectrometer there is a slicer, so that rearranges the data into a slice of one time. And rearrange this way to be sent to the grating. Now, the third the PACS spectrometer, and 25 PACSs are along this row, and for each PACS, there are spectral pixels. So, all together, spectral pixels, 25 spatial pixels. It's very important to really understand the organization of the data. Okay, so what happens is that when the chopper moves, for each chopper position, the grating also moves to a different wavelength. So you have basically the chopper moves from position from minus to plus. The grating moves, observe one wavelength. Then the chopper moves again, and the grating moves to another wavelength. And so over time, all the requested wavelength range requested by the observer is observed. And also, because the chopper is moving between the on and the off, also different positions, the source and the sky, are continuously observed. Now, the requested wavelength range is observed twice for each observation. So the grating moves up, so from, the minimum wavelength requested by the observer to the maximum one. And then the grating moves in the opposite direction in the second part of the observation. So again, each wavelength range in each observation is observed at least twice. And the same scheme is then repeated for nodes. So to understand what happens in the pipeline, but also in the products that you have from the archive, to understand that this scheme is very important, because during the processing, and in particular between level 0.5 and 1, the two chopper positions are subtracted from each other. So basically, the sky is subtracted from the source of the. Then between level 1 and level 2, the node positions are subtracted. So again, in level 1, the sky is subtracted from the source, and in level 2, the node positions are combined. Now, each chop node observation and unchop observation can be either pointed or mapping. So in a pointed observation, you basically stare at a given position in the sky with your eye view. While in a mapping observation, as the word says, you map. So there are round surfaces. And then you can have, again, two additional modes, which is the line observations or range observations. So in a line observation, you only observe a limited range in wavelength, while in the range observations, which is also called the SED mode, the range is much wider. So in summary, to understand a little bit what is the range of cases that you can have, a given observation can be line of range, chopper and chop, pointed or mapping. So each observation will be a combination of these three cases. So it could be a line, chop, node observation, pointed, or it could be range, or as you said, range and chop. And again, a combination of both. So I just want to give you a couple of examples of the signs that the performance has done. These are two extragalactic examples, the one and this one and the next. This is an example of images taken from one of the key programs, Kingfish. So in this case, this particular galaxy, NHSC 4521, has been observed in different lines, so in C2, O3, and N2, and also O1. And you can see again the power of this IFU observation that in this case are mapping observations. So in Kingfish, they literally map entire regions, strips, across the galaxies, and of course this allows to do great stuff in science nearby.
Why is the coverage of the spectroscopy?
honestly, I don't, you know, I, you know. Maybe I should, you know. The question was why the coverage for the nitrogen 2 is much smaller than.
I think it was just a matter of time, how much time we had. They didn't do, just didn't have time to do it.
Instead of doing it,
they did a nuclear thing and then a strip for some of them, not all.
Yeah, so it wasn't in combined with one or the other. So you see some of
just
the things are identical. They'll have to do that one with Sophia.
They'll have to do for new observation. And again, this is another famous extragalactic example of the science done by the PACS spectrometer. This is observations of these huge molecular outflows in an AGN from the shining key program by Ekastorm, who is currently the PI, as I mentioned yesterday. Now, this is the main point of the talk, to really understand the structure of the product in light, you know, after, you know, once we have clarified a little bit what is the IFU concept and the observing modes. Here, for those of you who were present during the photometer talks, this part could be a little bit of a repetition, but I think it's good to understand, you know, like the dynamics of how you go from looking for data in the archive to looking at the data in Hive. So the first point, as I said yesterday, is to look at the HSA, so to go in the archive. In this case, we do a search in the archive for observation. So I'm interested in this object, GL490. I set my search radius to 5 arc minutes, and in this case, because we are looking for PACS spectrometer observations, I set PACS. And now, instead of selecting the photometer as we did yesterday, we select only line spectrometer. Now, the caveat, there is a caveat for the spectrometer as for the photometer, you know, is that you want to if you want your search to be comprehensive of all the observations in the archive, you have to make sure that you repeat the search twice. This will look only for line observations, not for range SDOs. So make sure that if you don't know what kind of observations you're after, you select both and you repeat. So these are the line observations in the archive for the T-subject. So we have two ops IDs. And I'm going to focus on one of the two, and we are going to explore the archive content for the selected ops ID. I'm going, you know, as yesterday, I'm going to pick one of these two observations without any criteria. Of course, you might be in a real case, you might be interested in one specific ops ID for. So the best way to visualize the data, as usual, is height. So here we load the ops ID 13, 421, and 153 in height. So we use the get observation command, and the usage is equal true. So we are grabbing the data directly from the repository at Esaki Madrid. When you do this, you will have the variable ops appearing under variables. If you double click, you will have a description of the observation context appearing here under data. Now, as I pointed out yesterday, it's always very good practice to take a look at this section, which is the summary of the observation, in which in this case you can see the object which has been observed, that ops IDs, the line spectroscopy observation. You can see also the SPG version of the data, which has been used for this processing. And you can see that this observation was pointed, not nothing. So there is a bunch of information here. if you click under metadata, there will be also another set of important information that you want to take a look at.
Yes, you sure you don't find out what frequency it's, what wavelengths.
No, not from here. Not from here. So we will see, in fact. So this is like for the photometer. You have to dig a little bit more into the data to find out. So now we are going to explore the data, the organization of the data. So we have these levels, and the different levels correspond to different levels of processing. And as usual, higher levels correspond to higher level of processing. So level 2 is basically the level you want to look at to do time, or at least you want to look at the if you need to process this, and you can. Well, before going into the description of the levels, this is basically a summary slide that gives you really the overview of how the data are organized. So the important part is the following. So at the beginning of the processing, so between level 0 and level 0.5, the most important thing that happens is that the data are sliced according to node position, raster position, and line. This doesn't happen for the photometer. So yesterday you didn't hear me saying that, because this is very particular for the spectrometer. So again, the observation is sliced. So basically, in the HSA interface, there is, instead of using name, you can select the coordinates. So as I said, so at the beginning, what happens here is the slicing of the data for node position, raster position, and line. So for each of these slices, we will have basically this type of sequence, which goes from the organization of the data in, let's say, the detector framework to the SKY framework, the IFU framework, and with the product with generation of this cube. And for each, let's say, node position, we will have an associated cube, and the same for each raster position and line. So let's assume to consider, for example, a node position. Then, so I have sliced and identified my node position between level 0 and level 0.5. And level 1, I will have before level 1, between level 0 and level 0.5, my data will be organized like this. So I will have the 25 spatial pixels times the 16 spectral pixels. So as you remember, this is the same layout of the actual instrument. And the first dimension in my cube will be time. So I will have all the basically the observations, all my chop positions and my grating positions organized in this way. When I go to level 1, in my level 1, I will have the so-called PACS. The PACS tube has correspond to a reorganization of the data. So here I go from the detector layout to the IFU layout. So basically, these are my 5x5 spaces. So my row of 25 spaces is now reorganized by 5x5, which is the projected IFU on the sky. And the third dimension will not be time anymore, but it will be lambda. So all the wavelengths observed by migrating during observation. It is important to note that in this case, all my wavelengths observed, all my spectra, are shuffled together. So in this case, we basically have what we call a cloud of observation. And you will see this more clearly when we look at the data at the various levels. In level 2, we have the creation of the so-called ribbing tube. So the third dimension is basically ribbing in order to have a regular gridding in lambda which is regular but not SPD. And this is also important to understand what field we stay in the next talk and not to follow his presentation about DS9. So keep in mind that Ribbing cubes have a regular gradient in lambda, but not SPD. This is the final product to use for stereo observation, so in which basically you don't have, you're not nicely sampled partially. So your observation doesn't sample from a nicely point of view your beam. So in this case, for stereo observation, this is where you want to stop. For mapping observation, the pipeline up continues, and creates these projected cubes in which the original structures, which have a size of 9.4 arcseconds, are reprojected into a smaller grid of 3x3 pixels. So if you have a mapping observation, this is the product you want to look at. So this is, again, the concept of the IFU, which is that we have seen. Now we look at the product. This is we start level one. Lastly, in most of the cases, you will never have to really look at the details of the product before level one. So this is why I'm starting from level one, which are these PACS cube. If you remember, the PACS cube are the creation of basically the transformation from the instrument layout of the 25 by 16 pixels time with time the per dimension. Here, so we go in level one from this layout to a 5x5 layout where the third dimension is wavelength. So here, what we see if we click in hype under level one, we see that for this particular observation, we find that these are 10 cubes, which are the product of the slicing of all the nodding and nodding positions. And in particular, in these cases, the wavelength range which has been covered has been sliced in five different wavelength ranges. So we have, for each wavelength range, we have two nodding positions, A and B, and the R stands for raster position. In this case, this is the line observation, so there are no raster positions, so this is why all the raster positions are set. So again, each line has two nodding positions, A and B, and there are five lines altogether. So this is why there are 10 past cubes at this stage. So we now go, and as you can see also here, you have the cloud of wavelength, which has been observed by the grating. So we go to level two. These are the Ribbing cube, in which, if you remember, at this level, we combine the nodes. So we combined, for each line, we combined all the A and B positions. So instead of having 10 cubes, now we have 5 cubes, because each A and B have been combined into one single cube. And the other important thing that happens here is that all the wavelengths have been redeemed into a regular but not equidistant grid. So before, in level one, we had the cloud that I mentioned before of points, and well, now we have, you know, like a much nicer spectrum that we can look at. So this is, we are looking at a pointed observation. So in this case, the Ribbing cube would be basically your final product. So you don't want to go any further. The pipeline produces automatically also a project because you are not nicely sampled. So physically speaking, it doesn't make any sense to work with a cube which has a finer grid but is oversampling your data. However, if you have a mapping observation, then the cube you want to look at is this projected cube, in which the pixels are now reprojected. The original 9.4 pixels are now reprojected on a final grid of 3x3 pixels, spatial pixels. So So this is a summary of the product and the name. And let me just mention that for those of you who were here yesterday, for the photometer, for PACS, we go from level 0 to level 3. You have probably noticed that this is not the case for this spectrometer. So for this spectrometer, we, for the vast majority of the products in the archive, the observation, sorry, of the archive, we stop at level 2. So there are no level 2.5 and 3 for the vast majority of the data. There are some level 2.5 for raster for SED observations in unshuffled mode. In this case, for this particular mode, the off positions are in a separate ops ID. So what the pipeline does automatically is to subtract the sky from the on position. So just remember, this is a very particular case. The level 2.5 only exists for unchopped CD mode. And this is basically done because this is a repetition of just let me say a few words about calibration, and then I'm basically done. The calibration of the PACS spectrometer is, as of today, of the order of 7% in all bands, with a 3 to 4% reproducibility. This is a big step forward that we expect to, let's say, a year ago, where we were around 10-15% of calibration. So the calibration has greatly improved. And as yesterday, for PACS, it's very important to talk about the calibration tree, and because all the calibration information for both and the spectrometer is stored in the CAL tree. So with this command in Hive, you can load the CAL tree. And the CAL tree has three branches, one which is common to both instruments, the spectrometer, and one which is specific. And all the calibration information is contained there. One reason for always processing the PACS spectrometer data is, again, calibration. So you always have to check that the calibration version that you are using is updated. So we have seen yesterday how to do it. So this is an example. So you want to check the calibration that has been used for processing your particular observation with the latest one available in the pipe. And if the two numbers don't coincide, this is a good reason, per se, And this is my slide on documentation. So,
I think 7% calibration is accuracy is completely overstated. I could believe 20. Maybe it's true for very bright sources, but for most of the sources we observed in gas, and I did direct comparison to photometry, which is about like better than 5%, I could find deviations of up to 40%, at least for the continuum.
What, when did you do this check with the photometer? Did you cross check?
I cross checked up to Hive version 10.
Okay, no, but then I believe it. Yeah, no, because in fact, a year ago, the instrument team was talking about the 15%. You know, and then there's been a lot of work we just been put to understand, especially the difference between two calibration schemes. That probably, you know, Phil and Dario are going to mention. For the spectrometer, there are two calibration schemes. One is based on calibration blocks, and the other one is on the temperature normalization. And there was a discrepancy, you know, that was not clear between these two modes until a year ago. It was a very big. And then the gap has been closing, narrowing down, and now we are, you know, below.
Yeah, but even if you take well-centered sources, we Oh, of course, I have a integral field unit. I can if you have a relatively strong source, you still have a threefold. You will see a little bit in the nearby pixels. I can do a fit with the point spread function and minimize it. I can get positions accurate to 1 or 2 arc seconds.
Joran, let me mention one thing that, you know, a year ago, so actually, during the last year, one big improvement has been, in fact, a lot of work on the beam. You know, because raster, fine raster observations of Neptune have been done with the spectrometer, and at the beams, there is a new version of the beams. If you have done this comparison for Hive 10, the new beams were not available. So now we have new beams. So, you know, because you do need to play, to do, in fact, on this game a convolution. So I think you may want to repeat the exercise with the new beams.
Because the new beams are really static. I'll do a check at some point. It's not important. I've published them paper.